Now, when we come to Psalm 138, the psalm that, of course, follows this one, this is another great psalm, by the way. And we saw the harps hanging on the willow trees in the last psalm. Well, in this psalm, they are in the hands now of the godly, and the harps are being used for the praise and worship of Jehovah again. The remnant have now come back to God. Now, this is a psalm of David, and because the temple is mentioned here as a reference to it, there are those that feel that he could not have written it. Well, the word temple could be tabernacle just as easily, and apparently it is that kind of a psalm that is speaking of the tabernacle and of the days of David. We're told here, and it's in the inspired text, that it is a psalm of David. And this is a wonderful psalm of praise. It's rather in contrast to the psalm that precedes it, Psalm 137. There we saw Israel in Babylonian captivity down by the irrigation canals in Babylon. They put their harps on a willow tree and they wept when they remembered Zion. But here is a wonderful prophetic hymn of praise, and it looks into the future. It looks to the time when the remnant will take up their harps again and sing praise unto God. Now, this is a psalm of David which he wrote. And it begins like this, and I'm reading this translation that's before me. I will give thanks unto thee with my whole heart. Before the gods will I sing praises unto thee. Now, I will give thanks unto thee with my whole heart. One of the things that impressed me in my last visit to Jerusalem was the fact that the nation Israel, as they have come to the Wailing Wall again, you see them standing there, many of them, with a little book, going through a ritual, some of them actually butting their heads against the wall, some of them wailing, going through a lip service that I'm sure touches the heart of many of them. But a great deal that you see there is just like ritualistic Christianity today, or probably I should call it churchianity, and it's nothing in the world but lip service. A great deal of our service is that. But after these people have been through the time of Jacob's trouble, the great tribulation period, and they've been delivered out of it, I tell you, there'll be no longer lip service. It's going to be heart worship. I'll give thanks unto thee with my whole heart. We need to examine our hearts and see just how we're worshiping God. Is it really with our whole heart? One of the things impressed me about Horatius Bonar was that he said that he went to God to repent of the coldness and indifference in his life and the sin in his life. And then he says, I went back to God and repented of my repentance. It was just a lip service, you see. And he was repentant of that. I think that some of us on Monday morning ought to go to God in prayer and ask him to forgive us for going to church on Sunday. Lord, forgive me that I went to church yesterday. I went to church and all I did was I sang the hymns lustily, but my heart wasn't in it. I prayed, but it was just merely a formality. I didn't enter into it, and as I listened to the sermon, the Word of God, it had no effect on me. I criticized the preacher, and I criticized everything that was there, but I never criticized myself. God forgive me for going to church like that. May I say to you, that would be a good thing for many of us. Now there's something else that's interesting here. He says, before the gods will I sing praises unto thee. Now, Luther and Calvin They explained here that the gods were angels of God. I don't think it's quite that. And others think that actually what he's talking about are the idol gods of the nations, and he certainly could be talking about that. But anything that you would have in place of God in your life, or what is between you and the living and true God, could actually be atheism. Whatever it is your God. A man said to me, he says, I don't believe there's a God. Well, I said, that's interesting. When you say you don't believe that there is a God, what you are really saying, that there is a possibility there is a God, but you just don't believe in him at all. To you, God is out there, but you can't believe in him. May I say to you, I think that's the position of the average so-called atheist. He's really an agnostic. We have seen this word before, and we saw it, you will recall, back in Psalm 82:6, and there it referred to the judges, those that are in the place of God down here, the representatives of God. I've always been mindful of the fact that as a minister and a preacher and teacher of the Word of God, that I'm to give the Word of God out, and I'm not responsible to you, but I am responsible to God. I have to answer to him because of the fact that people will look to you. And if you don't make the gospel clear, who is? And there's one thing. I look back upon my ministry, I see much of failure. I have many regrets. I'll be very frank with you. But there's one thing that when I look back, I can say this, and I can look in the face of God and say this, Lord, I preached your word the best I could. I did it the best I could. And you know, that's a great comfort because you do stand in the place of God. And judges that have a man that come before them, their life is in the balance. Now you can escape the responsibility as many judges are doing today and say, oh, I'm civilized and will not execute that man. But my friend, you're standing in the place of God, and he's going to call you to account someday. And maybe you're going to find out you weren't nearly as civilized as you thought you were. May I say to you that I do not know exactly what David meant here, but he says, before the gods will I sing praise unto thee. And it could mean, you see, several things.